And we'd like to acknowledge right up front that Godzilla vs. Megalon, affectionately known by some as Godzilla vs. the Stock Footage, is widely regarded as one of the worst movies of all time, and certainly one of the worst of the Godzilla movies, but we're not here to ridicule it. That's already been done. Instead, we want to try to tell the story behind the film because it occupies a rather unique historical place. Because even though it's considered terrible, it was very successful when it was released in the United States and received relatively massive exposure in 1976 and 77, and because of that, it's arguable this film is largely responsible for inspiring a new wave of Godzilla fandom among all those kids who saw it, and for simultaneously cementing Godzilla's reputation among the critics as a cheesy and campy character. Godzilla vs. Megalon, ironically, had one of the most successful theatrical runs of any Godzilla film released in the United States. It was released in the summer of 1976 by CinemaShares International, an indie distributor of mostly exploitation films, and they launched a massive and really effective campaign to get press attention and also to lure kids into the theaters. In order to ensure a G rating from the MPAA, CinemaShares cut out the scene of Rokuro's somewhat violent kidnapping, where he gets thrown around in the backseat of the Cetopian's car, and also they cut out a nude centerfold hanging in the cab of the cargo truck, and they cut the two Cetopian agents' death scenes. They also removed the opening credits, so when the film was released here in 76, it was a few minutes shorter. Not only did this film get a wide theatrical release, but this was the only Toho Godzilla movie to ever get a primetime network television premiere in the United States. On Tuesday, March 15th of 1977, the film was broadcast nationwide at 9 p.m. on the NBC network in a one-hour time slot, which required cutting the film down to 48 minutes to accommodate all the commercial breaks. The broadcast was hosted by John Belushi of Saturday Night Live fame, who introduced the film and performed little skits wearing a Godzilla suit. Well, the man who masterminded the exploitation campaign for Godzilla vs. Megalon, and who is largely responsible for making the film into the cult classic that it is today, is Mel Maron, who was then head of CinemaShares. And at this time, we're very pleased to welcome Mr. Maron into the studio to talk with us about releasing the film. Mel, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Now, before we talk about Godzilla vs. Megalon, I want to mention that your relationship with the Godzilla franchise goes all the way back to 1970, when your previous company, Maron Films, distributed Monster Zero and War of the Gargantuas for Hank Saperstein very successfully in the United States. At the time, the trade paper said that you were taking a big chance because these Japanese monster films were finished at the box office. So what made you want to take a flyer on Godzilla?
Well, I felt the audience, the kids of that era, you know, it was an exciting thing, the monster craze, and also the fact that Godzilla, while in its early career, Godzilla was feared as a feared monster. And then, of course, the whole image of Godzilla saving the world and saving Japan and the rest of the world, he became a cult hero. So
that's right.
It was a reversal, and I felt that the timing was right for the kids to have a hero, and not a Superman, but a monster that they were afraid of before, who is now a friendly monster.
Tell us about mounting the release for Godzilla vs. Megalon. The press called it the single largest opening for an independent film ever held in New York. But even before you took it to New York, you opened in a lot of other cities and you staged all kinds of publicity stunts, including a car caravan going through various cities with Godzilla and Megalon cutouts on the cars.
Well, we had come up with a gimmick. We thought that there was an opportunity there. We contacted the offices, the executive offices of the Beatles, you know, Volkswagen. And we thought that when we opened it in the Charlotte territory, we thought it would be exciting to do it, create like a circus atmosphere behind Godzilla. And again, as I said, we try to create Godzilla as a friendly monster, not as a monster that the kids feared. And what better way to tying it in with a parade and with the monsters in the cars, in the Beetle cars, and it turned out to be, you know, a real pleasant surprise. The box office numbers were terrific, and the response grew. And once you have established a playing field, the bigger cities started to come in and say, oh, wait a minute, let's look at this. This is not just a straight exploitation picture, but we think we can make money on it. And everybody was proven right.
The Democratic National Convention was going on when this film hit New York. And you got a lot of publicity for passing out Godzilla for President buttons and hanging banners all over New York City and other stunts.
Well, that was just fortuitous. Our publicity department and saw an opportunity. He thought that this would be a great tie-in. We came up with the idea of running Godzilla for president. It was not a crazy idea if you consider politics today. But that was the tie-in. It was just fortuitous timing.
Well, reading some of the old press accounts, I must say you really went all out. There was a Godzilla footprint in front of Madison Square Garden where the convention was held. And after Jimmy Carter received the presidential nomination, you had six girls in bikinis on the convention floor starting a Godzilla for Vice President campaign.
Well, the timing is everything. And the idea was, of course, to keep the Godzilla name in the front of everybody in advance of our opening date. So it was just a pre-selling tool, which is done today much further in advance.
The cornerstone of your campaign for this film was the theatrical one-sheet poster showing Godzilla and Megalon fighting on top of the World Trade Center, even though the movie takes place in Japan. The Dino De Laurentiis King Kong was coming out later the same year, and everybody was anticipating the climax of that film on top of the Trade Center, so you appeared to be stealing a bit of Kong's thunder, a bait and switch. How did that poster come about?
Well, again, it was our publicity department and our advertising director came up with the gimmick, you know, that, again, this would attract. We wanted to have something that would stand out, and he came up with the idea, let's go all the way and put them on top of the building, and a la King Kong originally, but it was just a stroke of publicity genius.
How long did Godzilla vs. Megalon remain in the theaters? In those days, a film like this would typically go from city to city or region to region, as opposed to 5,000 screens on opening day like today.
Well, I would gather, since there was no immediate rush, first of all, there was no video market, no TV to take advantage, so your money came from the theatrical release, and as long as theaters were able to play it and we were able to circulate it around the country, and again, as you pointed out, today they'll go with 5,000 screens, and films by the end of the fifth or sixth week pretty much have played out, you know, their entire, I think the figures that have been quoted, 93% of the box office gross today comes in the first 6 weeks of a release. In those days, you were in no rush to go anyplace because your theaters were the prime source of income. So as long as the film was producing and as long as we continued to get play dates, we worked it. And I believe the release was, if not a year, was close to 9 months, 10 months in active release.
The trade paper said your plan was eventually to put the film into 2,500 theaters. How close did you come to doing that?
I think if you'll find out, I think the exact number was about 2,100 or 2,200 screens.
How many theatrical prints of Godzilla vs. Megalon did you make?
Well, we started with 55 prints, and I believe we wound up with about 300.
How much did CinemaShares pay for the theatrical rights? Do you recall that?
Well, I can tell you this, that the amount of advance to Toho was inconsequential. They knew our relationship with Hank and our reputation of delivering, so their advance was minuscule in comparison to what they wound up with.
Somehow you managed to get really good critical reviews for this film from New York Times, Variety, all the press was positive. You had an unorthodox critic screening that was kind of like a kiddie matinee instead of a stuffy premiere. Did the reviews surprise you?
Well, we had hoped, again, when we set up the critic screening, it was not something that you normally did for a, you know, an exploitation film. You didn't give it the treatment, but we felt that they would consider it the same as we did, tongue-in-cheek, and everybody was going to have a good time. So we weren't really afraid of any reviews. We just felt that everybody was going to take it in the vein in which it was delivered, and that nobody was going to be looking at it askance. And from the technical standpoint or action or whatever, we felt that we wouldn't get battered with any reviews.
In 1977, CinemaShares released Godzilla vs. the Bionic Monster, but Universal, which owned the $6 million man, threatened to sue over the use of the word bionic, and you changed the title to Godzilla vs. the Cosmic Monster. Do you recall that situation?
I remember it very well, because I thought it was a ridiculous claim, but valid, you know, the point being that we weren't about to argue or fight over Universal over a Godzilla movie where we felt that we wouldn't have the capacity to win it, and wasn't going to be worth it to us to fight it. We didn't see any credibility, and our attorneys told us we would probably win or prevail, but it just wasn't worth the economic risk. So it was easier to just to change the title at the time. It was costly because we already had prints made up and campaign met up as Godzilla vs. Bionic Monster. Anyway, so that was the story, and we just changed the title, and it turned out to be a bad decision because the title did not attract enough people. So, but again, you didn't need a lawsuit, and it wasn't worth it, and we just decided, as I said, to back off, and it wasn't a big threat, but it was a lawsuit pending that we felt that there was no point in carrying it on.
You also released later in 1977 Godzilla on Monster Island, but these last two Godzilla pictures apparently played mostly scattered matinees as opposed to Megalon, which was in first-run theaters. Why didn't they succeed?
If I had that answer, Steve, we wouldn't have this conversation. I don't know. I just, I don't know what the realities are, whether it was a fact that the Godzilla movies had run its course for the time being. I don't know. I really don't have an answer for that. As I said, I wish I did.
By the way, do you remember the total box office gross for Megalon?
I believe the film did about over $5 million.
That's impressive. Well, you've released many films over the years. What place does this one hold?
Well, first of all, the creative aspects that went into it and the longevity of the theatrical release, the number of places it played, the box office gross, and the national publicity we got from the convention. So I think from that standpoint, it's probably one of the most satisfying releases I was involved with.
Well, thanks again for joining us, Mel. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, that's a very interesting interview, and it's certainly ironic that Godzilla vs. Megalon, clearly the worst of the three Godzilla films that CinemaShares released, turned out to be the only successful one.
This film is almost 40 years old now, and despite all of its shortcomings, one way to measure its success or failure is whether or not it entertains the audience it was intended for. And if you believe, as I do, that this film was made for five-year-olds, then it's an absolute success, because I can tell you anecdotally or personally that my son loves it. And even if this film signaled the impending doom of the original Godzilla series, and even if it somehow sullied the reputation of the franchise abroad, here we are all these years later, and it still does what it was supposed to do. And that's its legacy more than anything else, I think.
Well, one thing that I'll say in the movie's defense is, you know, I'm not particularly fond of CGI, and particularly CGI as applied to this genre. And I'm not really much of a fan of the Godzilla movies of the mid to late 1990s and early 2000s. But on the other hand, Godzilla vs. Megalon, as weak as it is, it has a kind of charm all its own, and it has an organic quality that I think really holds up in a lot of ways.